Hi guys, happy Friday. Welcome back to the Q&A with Dr. Dre, where I'm gonna be answering your skincare related questions as they've come through on the vlog throughout the week. If you're new here, welcome. I encourage you to subscribe if you're new. I post day in the life of a dermatologist vlogs, as well as skincare focused content. And I love sharing fun tips with you guys and skincare insights along the way. So. With that, let's get started. So the first set of questions actually comes from my Instagram feed. You guys have been asking me questions on there too. So if you're interested in following me there, you certainly can as well. I don't see the questions as quickly, but I do see them. So from Veronica Putani, who asks, what do you think about taking fish oil supplement for dry skin and eczema skin? That's a great question. There have been very small studies looking at fish oil supplementation and did show some improvement in both dryness and dryness and severity of eczema. But these studies are pretty small and preliminary. And so it's not something that's considered standard of care, and it's probably too early to start routinely recommending. But if it's something that you're interested in giving a whirl, discuss it with your healthcare provider, and if they're on board with it, then see what you think. So I got another question from an Instagrammer about stretch marks, what can be done early on in stretch marks? And that's a great question. So I encourage you to see a dermatologist because there are some interventions that could potentially be helpful for stretch marks. The medical term for stretch marks is striae distensae. Some people are just predisposed to them, and it has to do with they tend to occur in situations where the skin is kind of acutely stretched, like during a growing phase or during pregnancy, for example. And they are changes that are at the deeper layer of the skin, not on the top layer of the skin, the deeper layer of the skin. And two interventions that have been shown to be helpful for this are in the early phases of stretch marks. You'll notice they're actually red. And when they're red like that, sometimes treatment with a particular type of laser called a vascular laser can actually be helpful for the stretch marks. And then the second intervention that can also be helpful when used consistently is a prescription strength retinoid. Over-the-counter adapalene, while a retinoid and while FDA approved for acne, is unlikely to be beneficial, however, because it works on slightly different receptor combinations than the retinoids that are available by prescription. So if this is something that you're interested in, I would encourage you to see a provider like a dermatologist or a plastic surgeon. So the next question is a follow-up to last week's Friday Q&A where I mentioned jojoba oil. She says she's always used jojoba oil mixed with her regular moisturizer to combat the dryness from benzoyl peroxide. Jojoba oil has been shown to be helpful in dry skin and things like that. Okay, the next question comes from Michelle Parsons, and she asks about niacinamide. Niacinamide, guys, is basically vitamin B3, and it has been shown when applied to the skin to be helpful for a variety of skin conditions. It's been shown to be helpful for acne as an anti-inflammatory. It's also been shown to be helpful for melasma as a skincare ingredient. So yes, niacinamide applied topically to the face, there is quite a bit of evidence for this ingredient being helpful for these problems. However, it's not first line recommendation for treatment for any of them. The effects are usually short-lived and not sustained. Any benefit that you see from using topical niacinamide is unlikely to be sustained after stopping it. So it's something that requires continual use of the topical niacinamide. But I will say this, that oral supplementation with niacinamide, 500 milligrams twice a day, has been shown to decrease the number of pre-skin cancers that people who form a lot of pre-skin cancers make. This is something to talk about with your healthcare provider for sure, especially if you're someone who makes these little skin cancers that have to be frozen off. It has been shown to be helpful. However, there's always the potential that a medication you're on could interact with it. So double check with them and make sure that you get the right one, because there is also There are also formulations that contain niacin or nicotinic acid, and that can cause quite a bit of flushing and discomfort, which you don't want. So double check with your healthcare provider if you're interested in that, but do know that that data exists. The next question comes from Liz Torres, who brings to my attention an article that she found. Great doing a little reading. That's excellent. She points to a study that arises concern for generation of free radicals in the skin from sunscreen ingredients. And is sunscreen really worth it then? The study that you point out is a laboratory study on lung cells, not human skin, so incredibly different. And it's looking at the ingredient zinc oxide in combination with ultraviolet radiation in lung cell death. Your skin barrier is not a monolayer of lung cells, first and foremost. So that data is incredibly, incredibly preliminary and very, very premature to assume to human relevance. Secondly, we have very, very good data from human beings that that consistent use of a broad spectrum SPF 30 or higher zinc or titanium dioxide based sunscreen reduces the number of pre-skin cancers that these individuals form. So I would say the lung cell data is, I have yet to see that bear relevance to human beings. So absolutely sunscreen is worth it. The next question comes from Google User, who asks a great question. I love that name, Google User. What cream or serum to use? What is a cream or serum to use on the forehead for wrinkles? And the answer is there really isn't a great one. Wrinkles that exist with motion, like mine, for example, can be frozen with a little Botox injection by a cosmetic medical professional, like a cosmetic dermatologist or a plastic surgeon, for example. Wrinkles at rest, however, are mitigated often with fillers. So those are two interventions to pursue with a provider. There's no cream over the counter or in the drugstore that is going to help for wrinkles on the forehead. Okay, the next question comes from MC Pay, who asks about red and blue light treatments and if they're effective. So yes, red and blue light treatments for acne are helpful. And she specifically asked about the over-the-counter devices. And I will caution you this about the over-the-counter devices. Unlike what you would get in a medical office by a dermatologist or other healthcare provider, these devices are not regulated by the FDA. They are not, they're considered a cosmetic device, I guess. So they have not undergone rigorous safety or efficacy testing. The outputs of these devices is incredibly variable. So to spend money on something that can't guarantee a consistent output of an effective dose of the light, and I can't recommend that. If you have purchased one and you're using it and find it effective, that's great. Please share which one it is. I'd love to hear about that. So last week I cautioned you guys against putting apple cider vinegar on your face, that there have been reports of irritant contact dermatitis to apple cider vinegar. Now, what about diluting it? You could get away with diluting apple cider vinegar. I can't tell you what ratio to do it in because it's not something I routinely recommend. The next question comes from Kim105. Any tips on keeping your neck and hands looking young? Yes, sun protection is the best thing that you can do because skin signs of aging that occur on the backs of the hands and the neck aren't related to ultraviolet radiation. For example, on the tops of the hands, you can develop something called solar lentigos, which are sunspots. The ultraviolet radiation from the sun damages the collagen underneath the surface of the skin and makes it brittle, makes it frail, and as we get much older, makes it predisposed to easy bruising. And the bruising can leave behind discoloration. On the neck, you can get sun-related changes called poikiloderma of Savant, where you have atrophy of the skin, you have prominent blood vessels, and these little bumps that almost look like chicken skin. So absolutely, sun protection, sun protection, sun protection. And I'll give another plug out to my Cooley Bar cardigan, which I'll link down below, because this, guys, nicely covers up the top of your hands here. So while you're driving, it will protect the top of your hand while you're driving, which is great, because the windows and windshields in your car, while they'll filter out some wavelengths of ultraviolet ultraviolet light, they don't filter out the wavelength that ages the skin. She Who Dares 07 asks a great question. Is there a percentage of zinc or titanium dioxide that we should be looking for? No, what you wanna look for is the term broad spectrum, okay? That's what's most important. If the label says broad spectrum, SPF 30 to 50 is more than adequate. You don't need to worry about the actual percentage of the zinc or titanium dioxide in the cream. So the next question comes from T Fozzy 1. Do I need ceramides in my moisturizer for aging skin? So as we get wiser, we don't get older, guys, we get wiser, okay? Just embrace it. As we get wiser, we stop making as much oils and the composition of our skin barrier changes a little bit and we have a tendency to be drier. I think a ceramide containing moisturizer can be helpful. Ceramides are helpful in dry skin. Question comes from Elizabeth in Alaska. Hi, so exciting. I'd love to visit Alaska. It sounds beautiful, but only in the summer because I'd be too cold in the winter. And she asked, they're approaching a season where they have sun 24 hours a day, which that sounds like a very good for your mood. She's asking about should she be wearing sunscreen all the time. When the sun is out, regardless of if it's cloudy or what have you, you need to be protecting your skin. You know, while you're asleep in Alaska in the middle of the night, if you have dark curtains up, you don't necessarily need to worry about going to bed with sunscreen on, but you do need to wear it all day and in the evening while you're outdoors, especially, and while you're in the car. Also, get a broad-brimmed hat. And the next question comes from B Villa. Hi, B. She asks about a sunscreen that she saw in the Dollar Tree, and would that be worth it, a sunscreen for a dollar? And you know what? If the sunscreen is labeled broad spectrum, SPF 30 to 50, well then yes, it is effective. Sunscreen does undergo some degree of regulation in terms of the labeling and what they can claim. And if it has those terms on it, then you can rest assured that the product should do that exactly. The product has to do that. It has to have undergone testing to demonstrate that. That's what you want to look for. So if your Dollar Tree one does that, go for it, B Villa, and let us know. I'd love to check it out, so yes. Well guys, that's gonna conclude today's Q&A. I hope you enjoyed this video. Share it with your friends, give it a thumbs up, and as always, don't forget, sunscreen and subscribe. I'll talk to you guys in my next skincare video. Bye.